Ozzie Nelson was regarded as one of the most astute businessmen within the entertainment industry. He was the writer, director, producer of one of the biggest hits in television history and oversaw the career of one of the hottest singers in the world. When it came time in 1963 for Rick Nelson to find a new label, Ozzie negotiated an unprecedented deal that still stands as an oddity in the industry. Rick Nelson had been signed by Decca Records for the next 20 years, a contract that would assure him of financial security for the rest of his life. Decca wasted no time in issuing the first album, despite the fact that Rick Nelson material was still coming out of Imperial. By May of 1963, only 6 years after his first record, Rick Nelson's debut album on the Decca label hit the stands.
Take a piece of chalk, draw a line around the world about 100 times, and that's how far I'd go for your sweet love. Count all the rain in a million years and make believe it's a million tears. Oh well, that's how much I'd cry for your sweet love. Here's everything that you were to me in one simple line. I'd go to the ends of the earth to be near you all the time. You found the earth with its mountains high, the sun, the moon, and the stars in the sky. Oh, well, that's how much I'd give for your sweet love.
The first single from the album For Your Sweet Love was a cover of a song by Ray Charles, one of Rick's favorites, I Got a Woman, along with the ballad You Don't Love Me Anymore. Decca must have been surprised when it failed to chart, but any apprehensions they must have had been calmed by the next release checking in at number 25.
You just seem to bring along whenever you are all alone, need some company. You always turn to me,
With the change of label also came a subtle change in style for Rick. Gone was the rambunctious rockabilly of the Imperial years. While some rockers still appeared on each album, the overall sound moved more toward the middle-of-the-road pop, with a generous dose of standards and ballads. Jimmy Haskell explains the change.
It was a little bit the times, a little bit some ballads, softer things that were kind of forced on him. And Ozzy, of course, who liked all kinds of music and who used to have a band and whose wife, Harriet, Rick's mother, used to be the band vocalist, enjoyed all kinds of music.
Gordon Stoker also adds his view of the change in style during the Decca years.
Well, it's really Ricky's wishes. Rick really wanted to get away from that Ricky Nelson. He wanted his name changed, of course, to Rick Nelson, and he wanted to get away from that rockabilly because he really, you know, of course, the music had changed, and he really wanted to get away from that.
Regardless of the changes, Ricky didn't stop making hit records. Before the first year of his Decca contract was up, he was in the number 12 position with a recording that some say is indicative of his best work. Jimmy Haskell remembers how the record came about.
There was a pop recording, and I regret to say I forget who recorded it at that time, that of Fools Rush In at an up-tempo that Ricky had heard and asked me to listen to it, and I listened to it, and I said I thought it was great. And he says, let's record it.
Pat Upton would sing backup for Rick in the early 80s. He recalls performing the song live.
Fools Rush In. I think I enjoyed Fools Rush In live as much as anything.
Fools Rush In. Where angels fear to tread. And so I come to you, my love, my heart above my head. Though I see the danger there, if there's a chance for me, then I don't care.
Musical styles were not the only thing that Rick changed in 1963. In April of that year, he married Kristen Harmon, the daughter of football great Tom Harmon and sister to model Kelly and actor Mark Harmon. A year later, Rick became the father when his daughter Tracy was born. His marriage and the birth of his daughter added a new facet to Rick Nelson's life, that of family man. Over the years, his family would expand to include twin sons Matthew and Gunnar and his youngest boy, Sam. It is this particular facet that brings the most vivid memories from his friends. Alan Bush remembering Ricky, the father.
He loved his kids a whole lot. I mean, they were probably the number one thing to him in the world. There was nothing that he would do to harm them. I mean, everything he would do would be for them. Even now, I mean, everything that he left everything that he had to the four kids, you know, share and share alike is the way it was worded. As a father, I think that he instilled in all of them honesty and sincerity. Matthew and Gunner and Tracy. Tracy is probably the most duplicate person as far as inner person. The caring for animals and people and other things. Tracy has that, and I just see Rick in her every time she talks, really. And so, yeah, he cared. He really did care. He cared about how they reacted to people. If they reacted unkindly to a situation or to a person, he would sit with them and let them know, even to an animal. If they treated one of the animals cruelly, he wouldn't get mad at them. He would just sit down and say, listen, you know, this cat or this dog or that squirrel that you just shot, you know, they have feelings too. You know, they have every right to be here as you do. And that the right to life was one of his concerns. Actors for Animals, I don't know if he was an actual participating member, but he sure practiced it.
James Burton adds his comments.
He was a great family man. He loved his kids, and of course his mother and father and his brother David. They were very close, and his family. even in the last 2 years that Rick and I were together, his wife Chris, they were really close.
And Gordon Stoker.
He was so proud of the two boys. The fact that they could. That they could play and sing, and he was so proud of Tracy with her acting. He was always a gleam. You'd always, if anything was ever brought up about Tracy or Gunner or Matthew, there was a gleam that appeared in Rick Nelson's eye that I shall never forget.
Perhaps the story that best illustrates Rick as a father comes from his brother David.
I'm a producer-director with Casablanca Productions here, and we do commercials, and I was looking for a location out in Thousand Oaks, which is about 40 miles from Hollywood, and I really felt I was out in the wilderness. We needed a shot for a guy and a girl that was background of a lake scene and kind of backlit water bouncing, flashing sunlight, and I had the feeling I was really out there, and all of a sudden I look up and here's my brother rowing a boat around the corner with both twins with fishing poles sitting in it. But I don't think people thought of Rick as taking the kids fishing. It was somehow the farthest from your impression of Rick and his relationship with his kids. But he spent a lot of time at the beach with them every summer. And when he was home, it was good time. It was quality time. And they went skiing together quite often and took vacations a lot. So it was a good relationship.
1963 came to a close with the release of Rick's second album for Decca, Rick Nelson Sings For You. Coincidentally, he used that title three different times within his career for three different labels in three different contexts. The title track from the album would become a number six hit in the first month of the new year.
String of pearls out of the dew.
For You was released as a single, backed by another song from the album, which would become a modest hit in its own right.
Just goodbye, my friend, just a note. That's all she wrote. Look, Mr. Mailman, look at the writing. There could be no mistake. I just didn't think the hand that wrote so sweet things would make my poor heart break. Just goodbye, my friend, just a note. That's all she wrote. So please, Mr. Mailman, take away the letter. It's just a sad memory. No, Mr. Mailman, the sooner I forget her, the better off I'll be. Just goodbye, my friend, just a note. That's all she wrote. That's all she wrote. That's all she wrote.
For You had to keep the fans happy for nearly 8 months until in August, Rick released his next album, The Very Thought of You. The title track was a standard more associated with singers such as Nat King Cole, Frank Sinatra, and Tony Bennett. Nevertheless, Rick's cover of the song was pleasing enough to reach number 26.
Little ordinary things that everyone ought to do. I'm living in a kind of daydream. I'm happy as a king. And foolish though it may seem, to me that's everything. The mere idea of you, the longing here for you. You'll never know how slow the moments go till I'm near to you. I see your face in every flower, your eyes in stars above. It's just the thought of you, the very thought of you, my love. You'll never know how slow the moments go till I'm near to you. I see your face in every flower, your eyes in stars above. It's just the thought of you, the very thought of you, my love. It's just the thought of you, the very thought of you, my love.
With the very thought of you came the end of the top 40 success of Rick Nelson. He would not make the charts again until 1970. Although making music of the highest quality, the public's attention was now focused on a group of four shaggy-haired Englishmen known as the Beatles. The British invasion had begun.
Try to remember.
When we return, more albums, another film, and the end of a television legend as we continue Remembering Ricky.
So mellow, try to remember the kind of September when grass was green and gray. Yes, it's you, you're the one to blame. I'm in love forever. You say you'll never settle down, that you'd like to run around, but I'll get you yet. I'll get you yet. I'll get you yet, just you wait and see. You have those eyes, how they hypnotize. But I'm wise and I realize that you think, well, it's clever. My friends all warned me from the start that you'd only break my heart. But I'll get you yet. I'll get you yet. I'll get you yet, just you wait and see. When I took one look at you, that's all I meant to do. Now I feel this way, what more can I say, pretty baby? You are the one driving me insane. Yes, it's you, you're the one to blame. I'm in love forever. Your roving days are over soon. Now you'll have to change your tune. But I'll get you yet. I'll get you yet. I'll get you yet, just you wait and see. When I took one look at you, that's all I meant to do. Now I feel this way, what more can I say, pretty baby? You are the one driving me insane. Yes, it's you, you're the one to blame. I'm in love forever. Your roving days are over soon. Now you'll have to change your tune. But I'll get you yet. I'll get you yet. I'll get you yet. Just you wait and see. I'll get you yet. I'll get you yet. I'll get you yet. Just you wait and see.
Despite the fact that the Beatles and the rest of the British invaders had knocked almost every American musical artist off the charts, Rick continued to record. In August of 1964, he released a single which was, of course, spotlighted on the show and had a modest success.
There's nothing I can say. There's nothing I can do to make you care for me the way I care for you. I'm so in love with you. I'll always be that way. If you don't feel it too, there's nothing I can do, there's nothing I can say, except to pray that there'll come a day when love will start a flame in your heart to make you care for me. That's all that I can say.
That's all that I can
do. I'm so in love with you.
till you feel it too. There's nothing I can do, there's nothing I can say. I'm so in love with you. There's nothing I can do, there's nothing I can say.
In November, he followed up with a new album, Spotlight on Rick. Although he was off the charts, he still tried to generate some excitement with rockers like this one.
Let me tell you about a girl I know. I met her walking down an uptown street. She's so fine, you know, I wish she was mine. I get shook up every time we meet.
Perhaps the most memorable track of the album was a ballad reminiscent of Lonesome Town. The song had the same simple feeling and became one of the favorites of the Decca collection.
When I get to thinking about the past and all of the good things that were too good to last, I cry in my heart. Each little part of yesterday's love.
Yesterday's love.
A few tender moments when heaven was mine. The vows that you whispered with each kiss was divine. How empty they seem. They're lost in a dream with yesterday's love.
Yesterday's love.
Somewhere I lost you along the way, lost without knowing the price that I'd pay. I can't help but wonder problems and bridges to burn. You have to cross over and you never return. For dreams have their day and then fade away with yesterday's love. Yesterday's love.
Despite such recordings as Yesterday's Love, Rick could still not get back on the charts. Regardless of his position in the top 40, Judy Markey says that she, like millions of other fans, stayed loyal.
He had been such an integral part of my childhood and youth that I would always stay loyal to him. I mean, his music was reminded me of a sweet, painful time of my life.
Diane Kochik reveals how fans felt when the records stopped selling and what members of his fan clubs did to promote his records.
Well, it kind of hurt, really, because he wasn't getting the attention that he obviously deserved. And being a fan, you know, I wished that for him. You know, I just, I knew that there was more to Rick that people weren't giving him credit for. The fan club, we had that where we called radio stations. All of the people in the fan club did this. And, we got some airplay for him.
John Fogerty comments on the nature of success and the manner in which Rick Nelson dealt with his setbacks.
Nobody ever, you just have ups and downs. That's life.
Mm-hmm.
No one sustains at that white-hot peak forever. You just can't do it. But he chose to keep playing anyway. I mean, he certainly was well past the point of needing it for financial reasons or to prove his point or anything. He did it because he loved it.
5 months after the release of Spotlight on Rick, a new album, Best Always, hit the store. It was preceded by a single that would appear on that album. Although failing to make the top 40, it would please the Rick Nelson fans.
Walk in a crowd, hiding tears I can't cry out loud. I can't let them see me cry, 'cause they don't care if I live or die. And it's a mean old world, let me tell you, it's a mean old world. When you need someone, I sit in my room, it's a room filled with gloom. I sit and wait by the telephone, but no one cares if I'm all alone. And it's a mean old world, let me tell you, it's a mean old world. When you need someone, sometimes my friends don't understand me. Sometimes they can be so cruel. All I hope is someday I find someone to love my whole life through. I walk down the street, hide my face from the people I meet. They don't see the tears in my eyes. They don't care or even realize that it's a mean old world. Let me tell you, it's a mean old world. When you need someone, it's a mean old world. When you need someone, it's a mean old world. Babe, I need someone. It's a mean old world. Oh, I need someone.
The flip side to Mean Old World was penned by a duo that in the 70s would achieve their own success as musical performers. Here is When the Chips Are Down by Seals and Croft.
Chips are down. Hey, 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 what you gonna do?
chips are down. Chips are down. When the chips are down.
Even as Best Always hit the store, Rick was once again in front of the movie cameras, filming what would be his final theatrical release. The film was a lighthearted story written, produced, and directed by Ozzy. Rick's leading lady in the film was also his leading lady in life, his wife, Chris. Rick sung only three songs in the film. The picture was greeted enthusiastically by his fans, but hardly anyone else took notice.
Your love and kisses, your love and kisses, fulfilled all of my wishes. That's all I gotta have to make my dreams come true. You took me by the hand and made me feel just like a man, and little chills ran up and down my spine. You made me love you through and through, and when you kiss me like you do, it leaves me feeling awful fine. I gotta have your love and kisses, your love and kisses, fulfilled all of my wishes. It's all I gotta have to make my dreams come true.
In 1966, a legendary era in television history came to an end. After 14 years and 435 episodes, The Adventures of Ozzy and Harriet came to a close. By then, the series had become much more than a television show. It was regarded as a piece of Americana, a common experience of that generation in American society. All told, America had shared 22 years with the Nelson family. Not bad for a band leader and his vocalist. One of the most popular features of the show was the mini-concert by Rick at the end of each episode. Let's take a look back at some of the music coming from Rick during the last few years of the show.
Up and go where the four winds blow, and that's why I'm a guy. I got a woman way over town. She's good to me. Oh yeah. Well, I got a woman way over town. She's good to me. Kisses that you used to give are the sweet, sweet kisses I relive. You don't love me anymore, and I can tell, I can tell. Another boy has made you change. When I'm around, you're acting strange. You don't love me anymore, and I can tell. Is there anyone finer in the state of Carolina? If there is and you know her, show her to me, Donna. Try to remember the kind of.
When we return, Rick takes a surprising course as we continue remembering Ricky.
Oh, so mellow. Try to remember the kind of September when grass was green.
They don't give medals to yesterday's heroes, 'cause yesterday's over, and I've got to live for today. I'm going places and nothing can stand in my way. Yesterday is over. No, they don't give medals to yesterday's heroes. I know my way now. I'll never look back from this day on. I mean to borrow one day from tomorrow, and I'm gonna spend it on sunshine and things that I love. I'm gonna reach out and touch every star up above. Yesterday is over. No, they don't give medals to yesterday's heroes. So wrap up that loving cup. I'm a winner from this day on. Yesterday is over. Can't you see? It's over, and I begin living today.
By 1966, the course of modern music had changed considerably. The Beatles still dominated the charts. The first records by a television spawn group named the Monkees were hitting the charts. The hippie movement had started, and psychedelia was introduced into music. But Rick Nelson was never one to follow trends. He preferred to set them. Still, it must have been a surprise when in the middle of the era of acid rock, folk rock, and rock rock, Rick Nelson went country. Jimmy Haskell comments.
My guess is going to be that he always wanted to record country music. I mean, My Bucket's Got a Hole in It was a country tune that he recorded quite early in his career.
According to Jimmy, Rick felt more self-confident than ever.
I would guess that by the time he did that Bright Lights country music album, he felt that he had achieved enough control over his life that he could get what he wanted, so he asked for it. I think if he had felt he had the right to ask for it 2 years earlier, he would have asked for it 2 years earlier.
Hence, the confident Rick Nelson released Bright Lights and Country Music.
I won't stay home and cry tonight like all the nights before. I've just learned that I don't really need you anymore. I found a little place down. Forget so fast, I'll say those bright lights and country music. A table by the bandstand, a bottle filled with wine. Honky-tonks were made for men with women on their mind. Nothing else can take away this loneliness of mine, quite like those bright lights and country music. Bright lights and country music. A bottle and a glass. Soon I'll be forgetting that there ever was a past. And when everybody asks me what helped me forget so fast, I'll say those bright lights and country music. I love those bright lights and country music.
From the album, Louisiana Man was released as a single and had some success with the country and western audience.
At first, Mom and Papa called their little boy Ned. They raised him on the banks of a riverbed. A houseboat tied to a big tall tree. A home for my Papa and my Mama and me. The clock strikes three, Papa jumps to his feet. Already Mama's cooking Papa something to eat. At half past Papa, he's ready to go. He jumps in his bureau headed down the bayou. Oh, he's got fishing lines strung across the Louisiana River. Gotta catch a big fish for us to eat. He's setting his traps, catching anything he can. Gotta make a living, he's a Louisiana man. Gotta make a living, he's a Louisiana man. Muskrat pies hanging by the dozen. Even got a little baby muskrat's cousin. Got him out crying in the hot, hot sun. Tomorrow Papa's gonna turn him into mud. They call Mama Rita and my daddy Jack. My little baby brother on the floor, that's Mac. Red and Lynn are the family twins. The big brother Ed's on the bayou fishing. On the river flows
go into town. It takes every bit of a night and day to even reach a place where the people stay. I can hardly wait until tomorrow comes around. That's the day my papa takes the birds to town. Papa promised me that I could go. He even let me see a cowboy show. I saw the cowboys and Indians for the first time then. I told my papa, gotta go again. Papa said, son, we got lines to run. We'll come back again, cause there's work to be done. Anything he can. Gotta make a living, he's a Louisiana man. Gotta make a living, he's a Louisiana man. Gotta make a living, he's a Louisiana man. Gotta make a living, he's a Louisiana man.
Bright lights and country music was not accepted by the pop rock audiences, but did establish Rick with the country audience as a significant CNW artist. In 1966, Rick starred as the host of a television variety show called Malibu U. He also took the opportunity to broaden his horizons by appearing on stage at the Melodyland Theater in Anaheim, California, with the starring role in their production of How to Succeed in Business Without Really Trying. Close friend Alan Bush comments about Rick's feelings about acting.
He was less comfortable with acting than he was with singing. He preferred to sing. He did make comments to me on a number of occasions that I'm a musician, I'm a singer. And to him, the acting was secondary, and the entertaining the people and singing was the first thing for him to do.
Uncomfortable or not, Rick took a starring role in an ABC Stage 67 production, On the Flip Side. Again, he found himself tackling yet another type of music, for the score and the songs for the show had been composed by Burt Bacharach and Hal David. Ironically, Rick portrayed Carlos O'Connor, a down-on-his-luck rock and roll singer who gets some heavenly help from Angel Joni Summers, who had her own early rock success with Johnny Get Angry in 1962.
Let me do it my way. I know what's right for me.
Can't you see that you'll soon be back on your lonely shelf?
Won't you let me be myself? Please, let me do it my way. That's how it has to be.
Don't you know it doesn't make you one or ownerless a man to accept what a woman can give?
I know you've done a lot for me, but playing it safe, it's gonna be so fine, so wonderful and fine.
Now while there still is time,
After working with Bacharach and David, Rick released another country album, Country Fever, a companion piece to the earlier Bright Lights and Country Music. Again, it generated some interest on the country charts. From the album, the A-side of his new single was taken.
Oh, yeah, yeah. I shed a tea, baby. I told mama, I told papa, I touche your dee, je te pompon. I got a house on stilts and a $5 bill sitting on the banks of a muddy, muddy bayou. That's a lot, lot better than the streets of crowded cars, pawn shops, friendly neighborhood bars. But your mom and your papa won't let me come a court and says I can't make a good living for the child. But the fish bite good and the crawfish are plenty. Gonna make a lot of money when I take a city bride. Your dee, je te pompon. I got a paint can't run and your papa's got a big dog snapping at my heels. Get away, you mangy hound. The light's still burning and the ladder's by the window. I take a chance, gonna make another round. But your mom and your papa won't let me come a court and says I can't make a good living for the child. But the fish bite good and the crawfish are plenty. Gonna make a lot of money when I take a city bride.
For the flip side, Rick picked a song that proved that he could still do great things with a ballad.
Oh, can't you see what you've done? You left the only one that's me. I'm called lonely.
I'm called lonely. Love
is a word I use for games now. Is a word I just can't say somehow. Cause when you said goodbye, all I did was sit and cry. Poor me, I'm called lonely.
I'm called lonely.
Lonely is a word I know so well. Not a man anymore, I'm just a shell. Happy is a word that means yesterday.
Sadness
is a word that's here to stay. Oh, can't you see what you've done? You left the only one that's me. I'm called lonely.
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 It was around this time that a very special fan had her first meeting with Rick Nelson. Anita Young, president of the National Rick Nelson Fan Club, recalls the visit.
I met him on my 19th birthday. It was in 1966 when he appeared on the Ed Sullivan Show. I had been his fan club president for a couple years by then. As I say, he was going to be appearing on the Ed Sullivan Show, which was, you know, one of the rare appearances here on the East Coast, because at that time, he was still doing, they were still doing the weekly show, and he wasn't doing concerts. So we couldn't get tickets. So he, his office sent us tickets for myself, and there were five or six of my members that were also going to travel up to New York to attend the Ed Sullivan show. And we met him at his hotel. He came down to the lobby, he and his wife, Chris, and his manager, Murray Fullader, at that time. And they came down and, you know, met us. And I think the thing that I remember most is that I think Rick was as shy and nervous about meeting us as we were about meeting him. He was always a very, very modest, very shy, quiet person. And it's really, you know, that always surprised me, because with as many fans as he had and all, you'd expect him to be a little bit conceited, you know, because by then he really should have realized that he was very talented and, you know, very popular. But mm-hmm. he never acted like a star. He was always very down to earth and just extremely nice to everybody. And he talked with us and, you know, posed for pictures and signed autographs for about a half hour in the lobby. Mm-hmm. And then Chris took us up to their suite, and we had lunch with her while he went to do a rehearsal for the show. And then we were up there. I don't really remember the time exactly, but it must have been at least an hour. And then he came back, finished his rehearsal, and he, you know, continued to visit with us, and he must have signed 100 autographs and answered, you know, everybody's questions, and he was just, you know, anything he wanted was just, you know, he was very more than happy to oblige, and he was just very, very nice to everyone.
When Anita saw Rick the next day, she was to discover the generosity of Rick Nelson firsthand.
We went to the show, and, you know, we had front row seats. And after the show, we were one of the few groups that they let go backstage, which was really upstairs, to meet with Rick after the Ed Sullivan show. That was, he had to get special permission, because that wasn't usually done. And when we went upstairs, when he and Chris came out, he gave me a birthday present, and I was so shocked. And he was, when he gave it to me, he was so nice. He says, "I didn't know it was your birthday yesterday," and he just really, you know, seemed kind of embarrassed that he didn't know it was my birthday. But there was no reason why he should have, and that just really surprised me that he, you know, went out of his way to give me a present.
Try to remember.
When we return, Rick Nelson returns to the world of pop music as we continue Remembering Ricky.
And oh, so mellow. Try to remember the kind of September when grass.